Okay, well, welcome to Meet the Experts. This is very exciting. I'm super excited to interview you. I'm Cassandra Hesseltine, the film commissioner for Humboldt and Del Norte counties. And would you please introduce yourself and tell us what you do in the industry?
Yes, my name is Jim Vickers, and I'm a director and a stunt coordinator.
That's super exciting. So enlighten most of the people, the average person doesn't know what's the difference between a regular director and a second unit director. Can you explain what that is?
Sure. First unit or main unit director typically directs the actors, and a second unit director like myself directs the action. So the first unit will do the drama, I'll do the action.
Which makes sense that you are then also a stunt coordinator.
Correct.
Most which one?
Second unit nowadays, in regards to anything that has to do with action, is typically the stunt coordinator also.
Oh, okay. And which did you, were you working in stunts first, and then that happened that you started going into second unit directing?
Yeah, basically the progression is you get into stunts, you become a very good stunt person. Hopefully along the way, you've taken the time to watch camera and camera position and lenses that are being used. And then the natural progression then would become a stunt coordinator, where you start designing the action and working again with very closely with the main unit director and with the camera people. And then eventually, if all goes well, you become the second unit director and start directing the action.
That's super exciting. Now you have a sizzle reel, right?
I do.
Okay, well, we are going to play it now. So for the general audience who's watching, they can see the kind of stuff that you do. So that was really exciting. You've done, you have a great body of work that you've worked on, you know. I mean, House is amazing. That's what, you know, it was an incredible show. CSI Miami, you know, and all the other shows that you've done. And you were saying to me while the sizzle reel was playing that was mostly stuff that you second unit directed, correct?
That's correct. Actually, not only were they second unit directed, but I've been fortunate enough to have most of those sequences were all nominated for Emmys.
They were what? I'm sorry, say that again.
Nominated for Emmys.
Oh, nominated for Emmys, yes, which look at what is over your shoulder behind you is an Emmy, correct? So where did you win for that? What was that one for?
I won that one on CSI Miami. Of which I was over there for 9 years, and that was in the mid-2000s.
Wow, that must have been really exciting.
Yeah, it was really cool.
That is so cool. So tell us a little bit more about your job. What do you love about your job that you do?
You know, I've been asked that question many, many times, and I always tell people my standard answer is basically I get to play for a living and somebody pays me for it. You know, we play good guys, bad guys, you know, heroes, villains, You know, for me, it's all about, you know, the excitement of the job, you know, working with wonderful people and wonderful actors, wonderful directors. It's a huge collaboration between many departments. So I love my job, not just because of the work, but because of the people I work with.
Nice. That's really well put. So how did you get into the industry? I mean, what did you always know you wanted to work in film? Were you very like athletic, so you thought stunts? Like, what made you want to come into it? Because if I believe correctly, reading your bio, you were born and raised originally in Puerto Rico, is that true? And then came to the States?
That's correct.
Yeah,
that's
so correct. How did that all evolve into then becoming a stunt coordinator and working in the industry?
Well, funny enough, I mean, I've been a martial artist my entire life. It's funny because in another lifetime, I was a paramedic firefighter. And so my partner in the dojo, who was also my partner, and also was my instructor, I should say, became Don Johnson's bodyguard during Miami Vice, the series.
Oh, okay.
And so because I had days off from the fire department, a lot of people were asking him if they could train him, and he couldn't train him because he was very busy with Don at the time. And so I started training people, some of whom were actors and directors and things of that nature. And during that period of time, during Miami Vice and that whole era, we were transitioning from what we call John Wayne, the barroom brawls, you know, where there were big punches and big this, and you know, that was the action of the day. Mm-hmm. And the transition was becoming more what they were terming sophisticated fighting. And that was involving martial arts and things of that nature. And so these people that I knew that were, you know, in the business at the time asked me if I would be interested in choreographing some fights and training some actors and things of that nature for now, what they were terming sophisticated fighting. Of course, I jumped at the opportunity and started training these people. But, you know, it takes a lifetime to become proficient at martial arts, you know. So while they were really super game and they were really super dedicated, you know, they just weren't getting there on their own. And so eventually I was asked to double these people, you know, and do the fights. And then we would do the tie-ins with their faces, and they could do the limited, they could begin and end the fight typically, and then we could kind of tie them in throughout the fight, but then it would be me for most of the fights. And that's how I got into it, through martial arts.
Wow, that is utterly amazing. So are you happy that it happened like that you just kind of fell into it?
Well, it was, but yes, I did kind of fall into it. You know, it was interesting because, you know, I became, because I was one of the only people in the United States at that time that was a member of the Screen Actors Guild and also martial artist with my look and my style, I got so busy doing film and television that I was taking time away from the fire department to the point where my rescue commander eventually said to me, the fire department can't be your second job, so you're going to have to make a choice. And I took a leap of faith back in the late 80s, and
wow,
I came into the film and television business, and it's been a blessing. It's been wonderful.
That's really amazing, because, you know, like I knew since I was six I wanted to work in the industry, so I think it's always amazing when,
yeah,
it just kind of happens like that for someone, but is a natural, appropriate fit. I think that's amazing. And also just, I think it seems to me that if you did stunts, which is obviously safety first, you know, about when it comes to stunt work, you know, I think it's amazing that you do have the fire department, you know, EMT background, because that would really go well with, you know, safety issues. And, you know, and it seems like you would have that kind of training, so you would know in case something went wrong, or just knowing, you know, what kind of precautions you want to take, because, you know, you have that firsthand experience of when something's unsafe. So that's pretty cool that you had all that background to bring to the table.
Well, you know, and I can't tell you how valuable it was throughout my career, especially when we were in, you know, I've traveled the globe doing you know, stunts on different film and television. And there's places in the world in which, you know, we didn't have, you know, the proper medical care, and certainly not the proper emergency medical care. Mm-hmm. And I can't tell you how many times it came into play that my experience as a paramedic firefighter, you know, it really came into play in a very big way. And even today, as you were saying, and I 1,000% agree with you, safety is number one in my book. Mm-hmm. And so therefore my background not only suggests that, but demands that.
Well, and then other people who work with you as you're directing, if you've got other stunt men, women underneath you, they must feel so much safer knowing that that's the kind that you are, you know, that you come from that scope, you know, and that you have that background and ability versus someone else who maybe, you know, didn't have that as much, maybe didn't have the respect for safety as much, you know, but since you were a profession and, you know, had a professional in it, having that as a profession, it seems like that would make other stunt people who work for you feel a lot more comfortable.
Yeah, you know, I would hope so. You know, but at the end of the day, you know, that everybody that works with me, any stunt professionals or anybody else that works with me knows that, you know, paramount, the very most important thing to me always is safety. I won't compromise that in any way. And I designed the action in such a way, certainly nowadays, because we have so many different tools that we can use to, you know, make it even safer.
So what would you recommend for somebody who is interested in going into stunt work? What kind of training do they need to have? I mean, you talked already about yours, you know, but what kind of training would someone who lives here, maybe in Humboldt, you know, County or Del Norte County, the two counties I represent, you know, or anybody else watching or from around the world who wants to go into stunt work, what kind of aptitude or training do they need to do to begin a career?
Well, you know, it's funny. And again, that question gets asked a lot. And, you know, I always suggest to people, if most of the people that come into the business nowadays come in with a specific discipline, whether it's martial arts, whether it's gymnastics, whether it's, you know, they're professional motorcycle or car drivers, or, you know, there's a lot of military people that are coming into the business that are incredibly proficient at many things. Come in with something, you know, train in that. Come in with, I like to call it, as I tell people that, you know, that come and ask me that same question, I go, come in with a hook, some kind. You know, don't go, well, I've done this or that. You know, one thing we're not looking for is thrill seekers. We don't, you know, we're not in it for that. You know, we're professionals. You know, we're looking to get the biggest bang for the buck while being as safe as possible, and we're not taking any chance on undue risk. You know, there's a presumed risk already, but we're not taking any undue risk. So I suggest to young people or anybody that wants to come into the business to come in with your hook, come in with something, you know, get really good at something, because you're going to learn all the rest on the job.
That makes sense. And I really appreciate that you said that about the thrill seeker, because I guess that's what I was getting at earlier when I said, wow, that's really impressive that you had, you know, the medical professional, you know, fire department side as your background, because, you sound very grounded again in the safety versus doing it as a thrill seeker. And so that really makes sense. So what epic stories do you have for us? You know, all these great, amazing TV shows and movies. I mean, you worked on, correct me if I'm wrong, but I looked up some, you know, Grey's Anatomy, House, Lucifer, Training Day, Catch Me If You Can, CIS Miami, Miami Vice. You have all these and many more big name projects, you know, television and film that you've worked on. Do you have any epic stories of really successful and fun stunts that have happened, whether you coordinated them or you were in them? And then do you have any fails or close calls that you learned from that you could share with us?
Well, let me address the latter first.
Always end on a success, you know, you're right.
Yeah. Well, yeah, you know, because those are easy, those are fun, you know, but, yeah. You know, in our business, you know, failure typically means somebody getting hurt, you know, so yeah. So we don't fail, you know, we you know, we're the The biggest variable in our business is human error. You know, because nowadays with all the techniques that we use and all the equipment that we use, it's very, very, very rare that we'll have a mechanical build. You know, so that's why we rehearse so much. That's why we, you know, we run through everything so much. And it's why I make sure that everybody's comfortable doing what they're doing, you know, and is able comfortably to say, you know, this isn't, I don't feel comfortable about this. You know, here's my concerns. You know, I mean, some people need to be able to say that and say it comfortably, you know, without feeling that there's going to be any type of repercussion at all. And there, in my world, there never is. In fact, it's
that's great.
Appreciated.
As far as
successes go, gosh, I mean, there's been, you know, look, you know, one of the things that I was listening to when I was listening to the interview with Elon is that, you know, especially in television, which I've been in with for the last 18 years, we got little time. We're doing big action sequences in little time, you know, and so we got to go on top of keeping everybody safe, on top of rehearsing. And boy, I tell you, we have a blast, you know, putting it all together and working with, and again, let me just say this, that, you know, we work so closely together with visual effects now and physical effects, you know, that, you know, it's such a collaboration of many departments. But I think that if I'd have to say, and I've been just, actually somebody just told me this the other day, I did a movie years ago called Equilibrium with Christian Bale. And this is, you know, Christian wasn't that big of a movie star at that point in time. And it was with Angus McFadden, Christian Bale, and Taye Diggs. And we did a show called Equilibrium. It was right during the Matrix era. And we were kind of very proud of ourselves on that show because we were going to do all of these crazy martial arts movements with no wires. And that was going to set us apart from everybody else. And the one thing that we were going to do was in the movie, there was something called a gun kata, which was basically a martial arts. A kata is basically you're fighting invisible opponents. And in this case, with the gun kata, the students in the film were learning how to use guns as an extension of themselves, which is in weaponry in the martial arts, a weapon is an extension of the martial artist. That's the way we look at it. So that we can become proficient at it after you do it many times. And so during this period of time, we did all these gun katas, and Christian, who's amazing, learned all this stuff along with all the other guys. And we did it with swords, and we did it with guns and all this other kind of stuff. And we had a great time doing it. And it's kind of become this cult movie, you know, and unbeknownst to me, all of a sudden people lately have been coming up to me and going, you did Equilibrium, didn't you? And I'm like, yeah, that was like a million years ago. And they're like going, the gun kata is the coolest thing. You know that all of John Wick and all of these movies that have come out now and that are all these big gun movies, I think they all reference Equilibrium. And that wow. Movie this cult movie and this standard by which all these current movies are working themselves towards or trying to stand up to it. It's been amazing. So for me, it's been this incredible thrill, you know, to have all these young people and these wild movies that are coming out now know that they've been using that little film that we did all those years ago as a reference. It's been thrilling.
That would really be exciting. And I'm looking it up right now, and it looks like it was released in 2002. So it would have been about 20 years ago, 18 years ago.
Yeah.
That's great. Really, that's so nice, isn't it? It's very validating when you work really hard and do something like that. And now people are, you know, letting you know that it was really influential.
Yeah, it's been, you know, and I'm, you know, it's, I'm not great on receiving those type of, you know, it's like, it's kind of a little bit, kind of like shocking a little bit, No, I'm not. I don't like to be the center of attention or have the spotlight put on me. So, but it's been thrilling.
That's very sweet. Yeah. It's humbling, you know, when you, I mean, what it really is someone saying, hey, you worked really hard and we see it. You did a great job at doing that. And that's, and then creatively how you put that, you know, we talk a lot about how film is both right and left brain, right? You know, there's so many logistics, but then you also, there's a creative aspect for sure. You know, in every department, there's still the logistical part of it. And then there's the creative part of how do you tell the story within your department, you know? And so that's really cool that you're, you know, benefiting from all your hard work, you know?
It stands the test of time, which is always fun. And if I mention one other thing, I would say that over the course of these many years, especially in television, is we've developed certain things that we do to eliminate safety or eliminate safety concerns. Mm. I should say, not eliminate safety, of course.
No.
And one of those is car hits. Car hits are like a 50-50 back in my day. Car hits, when you were doing a car hit, it was a 50-50 shot that you were going to the hospital. That was the odds.
What's a car hit? Tell us first what that is so that we know what you're talking about.
Well, a car hit is basically back in my time. You would basically, let's say it's that part of the movie or television that you've seen in which that person is walking out into the street and they're looking back and not paying attention and a car hits them. And they go up and over the car and go to the ground the whole 9 years.
So you're saying 50% of the time people would get injured.
50% of the time you go to the hospital. Yeah.
Wow. Scary.
So in that respect, you know, and what we've done over the course of the years and what I kind of developed, you know, and I've passed along to all my fellow stunt coordinators and certainly to the younger stunt coordinators is that there's no need to do that. None. Because if you watch a car hit, a good car hit on film, typically what we do is we set up about 5 cameras. You know, we put a camera inside the car to see the windshield. We put a camera outside to see the point of impact. We do a wide shot of the guy getting spit off the car, you know, rolling off the car. We have a camera down low of the person rolling into the camera. All of these different camera angles that we do, hoping that they would work, you know, for that one car hit. And so what I did over the course of these many years is I simply said, let's take those 5 camera angles and let's just do the action for that one camera. You know, and then what we would do back in the day when I first started doing it is that the first, you'll see the car, you'll see the camera in the windshield of the car and you'll see the guy walk out, the wide shot of the guy walk out, look away, and see the camera in the windshield of the car coming towards the guy that's not looking, right? Then you see the impact. And so what we did is we started doing what we would call a reverse mag when we used to use film. So we would reverse the film, and I'd put the guy on the hood of the car, right? I'd do the first shot, I have the hood of the car, have him stand up, and the car pull away.
That's brilliant.
Then we, that same, he's already on the hood of the car, so I'd put him on the hood of the car, and I'd put a bunch of pads, I'd spit him off, I'd have him roll off the car onto pads, and then what I would do is then I would already have him almost off the car and have the car pull forward, and he'd go off the car and he'd roll into that close-up on the camera on the other side. So we broke it up into what I called editorial pieces. And so what we did was we took a stunt that was a 50-50 shot of going to the hospital and made it maybe, I mean, if you maybe you hurt a finger or you scraped your elbow, that was about the worst that was going to happen.
So why do you think it took years of developing a technique and you coming in to say, hey, why don't we do it this way? Why were they doing it all in one actual gigantic, risky, you know, way of doing it versus breaking it up with the 5 cameras, like that, the 5 angles?
I have no idea.
That's probably the best answer to any of my questions so far.
And know that I had done many car hits myself, you know, and I would watch the end result go. I would get banged up so hard, or, you know, or I'd get, you know, right. I've taken a couple of runs to the hospital myself. And I would wonder, and I, you know, after seeing the end result, I'm like, oh, God, you know,
unnecessary
car hit, and it doesn't even look like anything. They broke it up into these five pieces, you know, right. So it was just one of those aha moments, one of those light bulb moments. Yeah.
And so that's interesting. So you were able, you were able to change the industry then, you know, the standard of how you do that.
Well, and know this, that the people that I speak with and the people that I, you know, shared this with, and I am an open book, you know, there's still those people that go, you know what, I think we should still do a car hit as a car hit. And I'm like, there's no reason for it. It's like there's no reason for high falls anymore. We use wires. I haven't done a legitimate high fall from unless it's a what we call a low fall. Then we can go into boxes or pads or whatever. But a high fall, you know, 50, 60, yeah. 70, 80, going into an airbag is unheard of nowadays because there's no reason for it. We can eliminate 100% of the risk. And just do it on wires.
Wow, and that's amazing.
Base the wire,
right?
You know, so you know, it's all about for me on a personal level. It's all about. That's why I was saying that there's a natural progression of becoming a great stunt person and learning that trade. You know, right. And then moving from not rush it because nowadays they're rushing it. You know, there's stunt people that are stunt coordinator position. So quickly, they don't even know the job of the stunt. And I have a belief that if you shouldn't ask somebody to do anything that you haven't done yourself, because you need to know how it feels.
Right.
You know.
That makes
sense. And so, therefore, you know, we you know, that with that progression, you learn all this kind of things, and you know, you figure it all out, and hopefully. You need to know that the business is progression.
Yeah, it is.
But I mean, it's like, and you need to know the tools, and the tools are what you learn as a stunt person. What does a physical effect person do? What are they doing? What is the visual effects person doing? How can we do this? Make it super big and do it really safely and, you know, augment that stunt and make that stunt even better with the collaboration of all these other departments.
So talking about visual effects, how that field has grown now within the industry? How has that changed doing stunts and coordinating stunts?
Well, it's, you know, for me on a personal level, it's made it better. It's made it a lot better. I mean, we still need to do stunts. It hasn't taken away from what we do, but what it's done is it's made it more safe. Because now with visual effects, you know, instead of going through, like when I was, you know, I've been burned, blown up, and, you know, broken, you know, I mean, everything, you name it, throughout my career, and the men before me and the women before me, are, you know, very, some of these folks can't even walk, you know, they're, you know, these guys consider, remember that, that's, I consider stunt people professional athletes. They make their living with their body, right. You know, but we try to, as we progress through the business, you know, we now have visual effects and visual effects, like I said, no more high fall. Everything's on wires, right. You know. Right. The big explosion doesn't need to be a massive explosion. I mean, I've got, you know, burns on me from massive explosions that didn't need, back in the day, they had to be there because we didn't have visual effects.
Right. You know, couldn't add it in post.
You couldn't add it in post. You couldn't enhance that explosion. Now we can take an explosion and have a fire source or an explosion source and pull a guy back on a wire on a ratchet. And then make that explosion gigantic. Have it come through the fire. I have pictures of me that people have given me in which I'm actually in real life coming through the fireball. You know, we don't do that anymore. You know, you don't need to, you know, we're still putting gel and we're still taking the precautions with heat and things of that nature. And all of the precautions I always have, you know, in my, on my end and with my folks and my group, we are redundant in safety. So even though I know I have somebody on wires, I still build a catch, you know, which is something in case we had a mechanical failure. You know, we want to be redundant in our safety, not just singular in our safety, you know. So, but visual effects for me has been a godsend. And not only that, but now we can use the actors and we can put them on green screen and, you know, we can really put them right in the middle of the action. So
that makes sense.
For me, it's been wonderful.
Oh, that's great. Well, and, you know, going back to what you were just saying about, you know, being pulled through a fire, what was that like right before you would do those kind of stunts back in the day when it wasn't as safe and you did have to go through the fire? Like, what would go through your mind, you know? Yeah. I can only imagine. Because, I mean, you started the conversation off, this interview off with, I get paid to play. But now you're telling me you were dragged through fire.
Well, look, there's been a couple of times over the course of my career in which I've had that discussion with myself.
Yeah.
And said, you know what, it's been a lot of fun. You know,
yeah.
If this goes, it's been one hell of a ride. You know, it's been fun.
Yeah.
You know, I don't want the young people today to have those discussions with themselves.
Yeah.
You know, lo and behold, you know, again, it was a different world when I started. You know, it was a different business. You know, I can remember a time that I was jumping from one building to another building, and there was a 14-foot span between the two buildings.
Oh,
and and so the coordinator came up to me and said, "How's your long jump?" And I went,
"Oh gosh,
you know, I'm pretty good at the long jump." You know, he goes, "Well, I need you to run and jump from this building to this other building, and there's 14-foot." And back then, there was no cranes or wires. They tied a piano wire onto my belt, my real belt, on my pants. I mean, it's not like it would actually stop me, you know? I mean, it was one of those kind of ones. It was like, oh God, you know, you're all ready to go, and you go and you do it. And, you know, it was a different world.
Yeah.
It was a different
world. Yeah. Wow, that sounds scary.
Yeah.
Well, obviously you made it, because you wouldn't be here talking to us if you didn't make that jump. So.
I lived.
So yay, yay for that. So let me ask you, because we are obviously in the middle of a pandemic, are you back at work yet? Because film has opened up in California and some other places, some other states and countries. Have you gone back to work yet? And what is that like if you have?
No, the studios haven't, we haven't opened up yet, but they're in talks of opening up. I think it's going to be a bit different than it was, because one of the big concerns is the action, you know, because we're in such close proximity to each other, we're making contact with each other, you know, there's a lot of that going on. That's one of the great concerns. And you know, I'm a member of the national you know, stunt committee for, you know, stunt safety. Mm-hmm. You know, we're having a lot of discussions in regards to how to get that done. And, you know, I feel like we can get there. It's going to just take a little bit of doing and some thought. But, you know, I'm feeling good. I actually just heard today, funny enough, that a friend of mine is heading to Montana next week to start shooting on a series that they're doing in Montana. So, I hope that work next. You know, I feel like there definitely is a path to reopening, but how we're going to get there and what precautions we need to take, I've got some thoughts on that, but that's a whole nother discussion.
Yeah. Well, we up here in the Redwood region have our first production. It's a small, short 5 days, and it starts on Sunday for us, and a couple days here for us. So it's our test run. With a compliance officer who's created this whole medical plan. It's going to look more like a, I've said this many times, but it's going to look more like a NASA science experiment than a traditional film set. But I think it's the right thing. If we're going to open up for film, then I think all these precautions, medical precautions that we've been implementing are going to be the right thing to do. So it's pretty interesting. And we have a lot of projects that want to come here and film, and we'll see how it goes with all of this. But obviously, again, safety first, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I think there's a way to do it and make it safe. But, you know, it's going to be like everything else. I mean, we've made it through this pandemic this far. Everybody I know has been safe and is healthy, you know, thank God. But that's due to, you know, following the protocol, you know, which is, it's not hard to do.
Right. Yeah, definitely. I agree with you on that. Have you been to the Redwood region? Have you made it up our way ever at any point?
I have, but it's been many years since I've been up that way. I did actually, it's funny because, yeah, we did, I still do Grey's Anatomy. And, you know, of course that's up in Seattle. We used to come up to Seattle and head up that way. And I know that's, it's up north, but I used to have to go straight through the Redwoods and everything like that. It's okay. Just beautiful.
Yeah.
I would love to work up there.
Right. Yeah. Well, it's an easy sell. It's easy for me to get productions to want to film here. It's so, yeah, I'm really lucky that really is, you know, what our main landscape is, the beautiful Redwoods and then the Rocky coastline and it, yeah. And it's always gorgeous on any screen, TV show, print ads, whatever that comes here in films. It's so, yeah, I'm originally from Orange County, LA. So I feel very blessed that this is the area I represent in California. So we do have productions that come here. And like I said, right now, because a lot of productions want to stay semi close to home, we have a little bit more than normal interested in filming here in our part of our neck of the woods, if you will. And so they want to hire a lot of times crew and local crew and local vendors to help them out. So if you were making a project here, what does our local crew and vendors need to know to be film friendly for the stunt team? You know, what kind of vendors or things do you need from them? What kind of, if you were to hire any local crews to be part of your crew, what do they need to know?
Well, you know, I mean, in our case, you know, and I'm sure that, you know, the same applies. I mean, in our case, you know, a lot of people ask me the same thing, you know, in regards to different areas. And because most of the shows that I work on are union shows, you know, so therefore it's a matter of becoming a union member or making the steps to work towards being a union member, especially if you're an athlete that wants to get into the stunt business. You know, I always suggest to people, you know, it really only takes 3 SAG vouchers nowadays, 3 SAG extra vouchers nowadays to become a union member, you know, so, or you're in an equity, which is in the live shows, you know, so number one, you got to have your card. Okay. But number two, I always suggest to people come out and meet the stunt coordinator, come out and say hi, you know, come out and do, you know, we, in our end of the business, it's called hustling. You come out, you hustle, you know, you bring your reel, you bring, you know, whatever your background is in the business, you know, and show it, take respectfully, you know, find the stunt coordinator, and ask that person, you know, if they have time to take a look at your reel, your local, you know, that's going to save the production a ton of money. And honestly, on my side, when I go into somebody's town, I want to use the local people because that's the way it's supposed to be. I moved from Florida, you know, so it was really difficult when I was coming up in Florida, even though I had a specific skill set that was really necessary at the time. I would watch other people that were trying to get into the business and they weren't given the opportunity simply because they were local people and they weren't from LA. So whenever I go to any town, especially any, you know, that has talented people, you know, I want to meet them. you know, mm-hmm. set it up, you know, let's give a call, go to production, find out who the stunt coordinator is, and go out there and give them your spiel. Ask for 3 minutes. All I need is three minutes. My best shot.
That's very giving of you and smart, because, you know, you don't know who's out there who has some talent up and coming who could, you know, be the next, you know, great star for you. So that's really wise to have, you know, you never know who's going to stumble into your world and that you might be your next favorite, you know, person to work with. So what about vendors?
And that's happened. Mm-hmm. I should say that's happened. That's happened many times. You know, that's all of a sudden I've there's this person that comes up that's just unbelievable. And that person becomes part of the team.
That is awesome. That is really awesome. And what about vendors? Is there anything that you ever need when you go out of town on location that you supplies or certain things that you end up needing? I mean, it sounds like most of your mechanical things are larger and come from, you know, industry vendors, but if you, like, let's say if you were to come here to Humboldt or Delmar counties and you were working on a movie, is there any type of supplies in the middle of the night perhaps you would need, you know, that we need to know about?
Absolutely. Yeah, a lot of the things that I don't like to travel with is pads, big pads, you know, fall pads.
Right.
And a lot of times we'll be looking for local vendors, local gyms, you know, local gymnastic schools. Foam company, you know, like down here there's a couple of different places called like Foam Mart that we're able to go get high density foam, because a lot of times what the art department will do is they'll grab these, you know, big pieces of high density foam and paint them like asphalt, or paint them like, you know, whatever the floor may be, and then we can just do it appears on film that we don't have any pads, but in fact the floor is a pad. You know, so
I had no idea.
So that's some of the vendors that we use a lot of. Typically we, you know, and again, especially, you know, if it's an area that we're going into in which there's a lot of climbing, a lot of our gear is climbing gear. You know, so vendors that are, you know, climbing gear companies, mm-hmm. things of that nature.
And we have that here for sure. We have outdoor stores.
Yeah, and you know, there's a lot of, we use a lot of, a lot of the different pads that we may need or look for or maybe missing come from like different disciplines like motocross and things of that nature. So, you know, it's all of those type of vendors that we're using. But as far as, you know, our bigger, you know, ratchets and, you know, mechanical things like that, we're gonna probably bring, because it's, I only use that type of equipment from people that I know very well, because I know they maintain the equipment, and I don't want to risk any type of injury.
That's amazing.
But everything else, I try to grab as much as I can locally.
Right, that makes sense. Well, that's really good for us to know, for our vendors. So we had a question that came from somebody on our social media site when we announced we were going to interview you, and they wanted to know what stage of the script is a stunt coordinator consulted. When do you come in during production or pre-production?
I start at the very, very front of pre-production. As soon as the script is available, oftentimes I'll get an outline even before the script is finished, before the dialogue is complete. You know, as long as they have a description of the scene, and what the action may be, you know, because what they, you know, that we, it takes a great deal of preparation for us to put a stunt together. And the director may have something in mind. And my mentor many years ago told me, never say no, Jim. That director will have some crazy idea that don't ever say no. Say, I hear you, I know what you want, I see what you're, you know, I understand what you're envisioning, but for us to get there, we have to do it this way, you know. So for me to take, you know, for me, it's important to get into the director's ear, for him to get into mine, you know, or she to get into mine, and to explain what that action piece is and let me help them get there visually, but being tech, you know, being, you know, working through the technicalities of it and the technical aspects of it and the safety aspect of it, you know, because that's, I got to go into whatever that is going, okay, well, how do I make sure that at the end of the day, everybody goes home and goes home safe?
Right, because you're the expert. They have this picture of the end result of what they want, but you're the one that has to tell them how they're going to get it, you know?
Sure. I mean, if we're doing a big car crash, you know, we just at the on our last episode of I'm doing 911 Lone Star right now. That's what I'm going back to. And the last episode on the of the season, the last day of the season, we're doing a big crash in which a garbage truck is broadsiding a small school bus, and it goes flipping over in the whole nine yards. And, you know, and so it's a matter of, okay, well, and then these people get trapped in it, and there's water going in, and the driver's drowning, and there's all these things that happen, you know.
Yeah.
And so, you know, it's like, it's you read it on the page, and it's very exciting. But for me to make that a reality, you know, there's a lot of steps for me to have to take, and a lot of prep, and a lot of rehearsal for me to take to get to that, you know, to make the, to honor the words that are on the page and make sure that I can, you know, I can bring to life what the director has in his or her mind.
Right. That makes sense. I really appreciate too, by the way, that you've been adding her in all the different disciplines when you, you know, have been talking. And so, because we are an industry that was a lot male dominated and, but is now starting to, you know, balance out. And so I appreciate that you say him or
absolutely.
Her. So thank you for that.
I work with as many talented female directors as I work with talented male directors. And it's been that way actually for a long time now.
Good. Well, thank you for sharing that. That's a positive, you know, moment or point there. So what else do we need to know? Is there anything else that there's probably tons we need to know, but what are your kind of final thoughts on stunt coordinating and second unit directing and, you know, what are we missing that we haven't heard from you yet?
I think that, you know, I harp on this all the time, you know, especially with young people that want to come into the business on my end of the business, mm-hmm. is like, don't be in a rush. Don't be in a rush to become really, really, really good at your job when you get in at first. Listen, you know, be that fly on the wall, you know, mm-hmm. look at the camera, learn what the camera is seeing. You know, ask questions, you know what I mean? Don't be, mm-hmm. you know, it's so funny because I'll see young people that are sitting around on their phones on set and I'm like, put your phones away, guys, please,
yeah.
all of them, you know, go, what is the camera seeing right now? Okay, why is that action working? You know, learn your craft, be really good at it and be patient with yourself. And become amazing at your craft, because that is what will give you longevity.
Mm-hmm. I appreciate that. Yeah, thank you. Those are really wise words. Yay, well, it was so fun interviewing you and hearing all about this. You know, it's interesting because even as someone who works in the industry, I when I was producing, I was making more low budget, so we didn't have a lot of stunts. And now that I work on bigger things. Yeah, it's the first thing to go. And now that I work on bigger things as film commissioner for the past 10 years, you know, I'm usually part of locations and a whole bunch of other aspects. So, you know, I'll catch stunts happening. I was able to catch After Earth when Jaden Smith dives off the log from one part of Earth and dives down to a different part of Earth, which technically was Humboldt, and he's diving down into Costa Rica. I was able to watch him on wires and how they were able to do all of that without attaching any of it to any of the old growth redwoods. And so it was a really fun day to watch that in this ancient 2,000-year-old forest and having Jaden dive off and then get back on and try it again. And, you know, and And so I really have an appreciation for it, but I it wasn't my strong suit. So it was really lovely to interview you and hear more about how it kind of works and all the safety measures, you know, that you put into place and how it's changed over time. So kudos to you for being a big part of it, sounds like. And now I think I'm going to look at stunts a little differently. You know, I might watch one of your projects, you know, tonight just to kind of, you know, look at it and go, ooh, especially the hit, the car hit thing, you know, that's exciting. That's really exciting. I had no idea. I had no idea.
Yeah.
So real, thank you. Thank you for helping us, you know, educate our locals and anybody else who catches this video online. It really is appreciated.
Well, my pleasure.